We are so honored as EquestriCon to have the distinguished guests that we have with us here today on this panel. They require absolutely zero introduction, but as procedure calls for, I will just briefly, obviously, introduce you to Mr. Ron Turcotte. Mr. Jean Kruger. And the spectacular Miss Donna Brothers. Won't go on for too long, just wanted to kind of point out that this panel, this Q&A, Triple Crown Jockeys, is an opportunity for you to learn more from our panelists about their incredible, not only their Triple Crown runs, but some of their other career highlights as well. And as you can see, Q&A, so you'll have an opportunity to ask some questions. So with that, I will leave it to the leader of the question asking here today, Donna Brothers.
Thank you, Dan. Thank you everybody for coming, and thank you for that really nice introduction. And I think Dan was actually messaging me that it's a Q&A, so that I don't get carried away up here. So if at any point you guys are like, wait, we're running out of time and I want to ask a question, raise your hands, because sometimes, you know, that happens. So before I introduce them with a formal introduction, I'm going to say in their defense, they did cross the finish line three times in front in the world's most important races, at least us in the United States. So I guess after that, they never really felt like they had to be on time or first again. So, so sorry that they were a little late. There might have been just a little bit of confusion about what time to get here, but they're here now. So Ron Turcotte, I'm going to start with a little brief introduction about him. He actually started off as a hot walker on the backside and did just about everything in his racing career. Just after winning the Kentucky Derby on Riva Ridge the following year, he wins the Triple Crown on Secretariat. And then after that, or during that time, he won over 3,000 races, numerous awards, including the 1979 George Wolfe Memorial Award, which is voted upon by his fellow jockeys. So obviously he was well-respected, but also well-liked by his competitors, which was great because when you've won that many races, most of the time the guys in the jocks room don't like you very well. And in 1979, he was inducted into the Horse Racing Hall of Fame here in the United States. And even though he's from Canada, it wasn't until the next year that he was inducted into the Hall of Fame in Canada. And then Jean Kruger, who's sitting here, originally from Agen, France, and as you hear Jean Kruger talk, you'll think that he's still living in France, but as you get used to his accent, you'll be able to understand him. He made American history when just 4 years after Secretariat broke that 25-year drought of not having a Triple Crown winner. He wins in Seattle Slough, and so in 1977 he did that, and it gives us all hope that since we saw the drought broke after 37 years with American Pharoah, maybe we don't have to go another 37 years before we see another Triple Crown win. So he immigrated to the United States in the mid-1960s from France, made his mark at Hialeah Park in Florida, and then also in New York, went back to France for a little while in 1972, and then he came back to the United States, and of course, we know what he did with Seattle Slough. He's a winner of Group 1 and Grade 1 races in four different countries. And just to put things in perspective a little bit, I think a lot of you know I retired in 1998 as the second leading female rider in the United States by money earned. But throughout my career, I won several graded stakes, but I never won a Grade 1. Jean Kruger won a minimum of 25 Grade 1 races in the United States and also the Group 1 races in other countries. And so, although you didn't ride in the United States forever, you certainly made your mark all over the United States and in the world. But I want to back up a little bit and just start with a little bit of their personal journeys and what got them even into the racing industry. Because I think a lot of people as fans think like, you know, everybody who is in the industry just kind of started there. And I'm going to start with Ron, because you obviously didn't start there. You were one of 12 children. You left school when you were 14 years old to work with your father as a lumberjack. And then at 18, you headed to Toronto looking for construction work. Began your career as a hot walker in 1959. So how did you end up even on the racetrack? And then how did you end up becoming a jockey from there, Ron?
Okay, I started walking, I started a racetrack in 1960 instead of 61.
Okay.
I rode my first race in 61. Mm-hmm. It was June 21st, 1961, when I rode my first race.
But how did you even get to, like, from being one of 12 children, now you're on the racetrack? How'd that happen?
Okay, I worked 5 years in lumber camps, you know, in cutting lumber. And I was, even though I was falling trees and all that, doing the regular lumberjack stuff, I was put in charge of the horses also. So I had to learn. Get up at 4 o'clock to feed my horse, to go have breakfast, come back, harness the horses, and go on to see the lumber spot we were cutting. I was snaking logs through the woods to the yard where it was to be cut. And in the wintertime, that was the summertime, in the wintertime I would haul, drive a team of horses to with a set of bobsled. That's two set of sled. There's one behind, one in front, and we haul logs with that to the main road or to the river where they were to be driven to the mill in the spring. They call that a spring drive. Mm-hmm. You know, I done that. I even drove a little bit on the river. Even though I'm not much of a swimmer. But anyway, my brother went to Ontario, and he worked there for a year, then he came back, and I decided to go with him because he was making much more money than I was. So when I got to Ontario, the carpenters were on strike, so he was doing some roofing. So now I started looking all over the city. After a month of looking for work, we were kind of disappointed. Really, it's much longer than that. You know, if I tell them how I live, I left home with $50 in my pocket, and with a friend, he had $50 in his pocket. We tried to Toronto, and we, after we ran out of money, we found a restaurant that would accept us to work for our meal. So it'd give
so
us.
So truly you gotta like wash dishes for the food. Like
that's right. We had dinner there and then we had to wash dishes till 9 o'clock. Then after that we run to a bait company and we'd go pick night trawlers till 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning to pay for our room.
So how did you find out that they needed help at the racetrack?
That's when I found out. After a month doing that, we're so beat one day, and it happened to be the first Saturday in May. And when we got downstairs, the landlord and a group of people were watching a race. It happened to be the 1961 Kentucky Derby. Mm-hmm. And A.P. Taylor had a 1960 Derby. And E.P. Taylor at a horse called Victoria Park was running in there, so there was a large interest in Canada. Into
E.P. Taylor's from Canada.
Kentucky Derby, yeah. So the landlord asked me if I had found work, and I said no. So he asked me, why don't I try the racetrack? And I said, the racetrack? I didn't know what he was talking about. So I asked him where there was a racetrack. You know, like since they were watching the race there. And then he told me there was one on Lake Ontario and then one 15 miles out, Woodbine, and then it was Fort Erie. So he told me with my size that maybe I could become a jockey. So I was asking what was a jockey. He said, he pointed out to the little boys in the white pants. He said, that's a jockey. So I says, well, Monday morning anyway, I didn't know that they work on Sunday, mm-hmm. 7 days a week on the racetrack, but I didn't know that. Anyway, I hitchhiked to the race to the racetrack. I was at the wrong racetrack. I was at Old Woodbine. That's what they used to call it. It eventually was called Greenwood. Anyway, I done that for 2 days, and I got turned down both time at the gate because the guard wouldn't let me in. I didn't have a pass because I wasn't working for anybody. I was looking for work.
It's kind of a catch-22 when you come to the racetrack looking for a job, because you want to get in the into the stable gate so you can go to the barns and ask somebody for a job, but nobody will let you in the stable gate because you don't have a license, and you can't get a license until you get a job. So you got caught in this catch-22 a little bit.
Yeah. So now he says the races are being held at Woodbine. So he says, why don't you try Woodbine? So I tried Woodbine, and I'm about a quarter from my, I'm in striking. And I'm about a quarter of a mile from the gate, and a trainer happened to go by. And he says, how far are you going? I said, I'm going to the racetrack. He says, oh, that's where I'm going. He says, open. So I opened the car, and when he went by the gate, he asked the trainer if we all had passed. And the trainer said, yeah. So that's how I got into the racetrack.
So your career began with a lie. That's okay, though.
So my bad luck always all turned out good luck.
Yeah, right.
So anyway, and he dropped me off at the office, and there was a man there. His job was to find work for people coming into the racetrack looking for work, or finding somebody for the trainer. He's finding something out for the trainer. So he walked me over to a stable that happened to be Mr. Taylor's Winfield Farm.
E.P. Taylor.
E.P. Taylor, yeah. Same person that owned Norton Dancer and Victoria Park. Mm-hmm. And that's where I started. And I walked horses for 2 days, I think. And the guy asked me, the trainer, you know, wash me now and then. He asked me if I ever worked with horses. I told him yes. He says, what stable do you work for? Oh, he says, our own stable. He said, oh, what's the name? Oh, I said, I never work with Thoroughbred. I work with work horses. So he said, well, I noticed you had experience with horses. He says, tomorrow morning I'll try you at rubbing horses. So I rubbed horses for 4 months. And then he sent me to the farm where I learned to gallop horses. So everything was going real fast for me. Mm-hmm. And so I broke a bunch of yearlings that fall and went into March, February. Then I was called into the office and by Joe Thomas, who was the manager of the farm, manager for all Mr. Taylor's racing operation. And he asked me, there was five of us that he called into the office. He asked me to sign a contract, 5-year contract. At the time. So I asked him if I could think about it for a couple of days. And the guy that taught me how to yell horses was taking me around with him when we were breaking horses for 100 miles around within Toronto, different farms. We were breaking here later from the time I started with Mr. Taylor. Anyway, he told me that it wasn't a good idea because Mr. Taylor never made a jockey. They always use a top jockey. Uh-huh. As it turned out, I was galloping horses galloping and breaking yearlings for a guy called Gordon Huntley. So he said, well, you should try this guy. So I asked him, and I got a job with him. And he told me after working for a while with him, well, it happened to be in May. He told me, he says, you know, you lose a little bit of weight. At the time, I weighed 130 pounds. Mm-hmm. He says, you lose weight. He says, I think I can make a jockey out of you. Because the horse I was working, I was coming close to the time he asked me to work him in. He says, you got good timing and all that. So anyway, at the time, you needed a contract to write.
Yeah.
Without a contract, you couldn't write.
Yeah, so just to clarify, back then, now apprentice riders can just start as soon as they get whatever they need, all their ducks in a row to ride their first race they can, and usually they need to have some sort of a referral from a trainer or the starter or somebody, but they can just ride a race. But back when these guys started, and also my mother, if you didn't have a contract, if somebody didn't put you under contract, you couldn't ride. And the contracts weren't always that beneficial for the apprentice riders. Usually you were just a little bit above slave labor for a little while.
Like you said, a little bit above. $30 a month. That'd be a dollar a day, I guess.
What did you say, $30 a month?
$30 a month,
yeah.
Plus food. But with Gordon Huntley, he was giving me $75 a week for galloping horses. He told me, he said, he was going to keep me at that salary and still have a contract with him. So I stayed with him. He kept his word. We became a very good friend. He was like a father to me, or like a brother to me, because we were always together. I'd help him at the farm. And so by doing a little, extra work, which was picnic for me, compared to working in lumber. So then he put me on a horse. I signed a contract with him. He put me on a horse right away. And the contract didn't come back in time to ride the horse. Then the next time he put me on a horse, I had a contract, and I rode my first race. And he put me on nine horses that year, the rest of the year, because at that time, I don't know if it still works like that now. At that time, the minute you broke your maiden, you rode your first winner, your apprenticeship started. Mm-hmm. And that lasted for a year.
Yeah, it doesn't start now until your third winner, I believe.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Then you get 10 pounds for your first, I think it was 10 winners, and then it dropped to 7 pounds, and then 5 pounds, mm-hmm. the balance of your, for a year.
Yeah.
You get a contract for a year. I'm in an apprenticeship for a year.
All right, well, let's
so now
go ahead.
I go into 1962. I rode one race, and I won that race. The next day, I was on two horses, and then two horses won. And Gordon Huntley was very noted to have his horses really ready for the beginning of any meeting, and a two-year-old especially. And, I went up leading rider, but then I got 10 days. Like, the first 2 weeks was leading rider, then I got 10 days, and rode a couple races again. I was 10 days again. So then we went to Woodbine, and Mr. Taylor wanted me to ride horses because ride for him, because I was winning a lot of races. I was very aggressive. Anyway, to make it shorter than that, I rode 2 years in Canada. I was leading rider both years. First year, I rode horse of the year. Picked up a horse that was claimed by Mr. Mooney, the man that rode the Dark Star in the Kentucky Derby, mm-hmm. in 1924. Was training the horse. He claimed that horse for $7,500, and he wound up horse of the year. We went undefeated the rest of the year with him.
Wow, so you were precocious from the beginning.
Yeah.
All right, well, we've got another panelist. We got to get Jean Kruger in here, and I'm going to let you tell the rest of these stories, Ron. Hold on.
Yep.
Let's get Jean Kruger in here for just a little bit.
Yeah, sure.
So Jean didn't have a precocious start because you lived in an orphanage from age 5, and then age 10 to 16, you were raised in a Roman Catholic priest thing, whatever they call that, orphanage at that time. But also you were abused, physically abused, while you were living there, and then you had a grandfather, or your grandfather had some sort of tie to the horses. Yeah. So talk to us about how you went from really a tough beginning to ending up at the racetrack or with the horses.
Well, I was during the summertime, I couldn't spend a couple of months with my grandpa. And then our neighbor, he had some daughter. So he tried to get a connection. Yeah, I didn't care about being a jockey at that time, I wanted to be a fighter. So I didn't fight for 1 week. And then the next time he say, Monday you come, we're going to have to work your nose, for the cartilage. So I didn't show up. That was the end of my boxing career.
Why didn't you show up?
Because you're supposed to break your nose for the cartilage.
Oh.
So I didn't show up. And then after that, I got my neighbor, my friend, my grandpa friend, he got some trouble, and he can recommend me to be a jockey. So I went to the, 20 miles from Agen, in the country, and I started over there. And,
So in France, is it the same way in the United States, or was it the time where you would have to sign a contract with somebody to start as an apprentice rider?
At that time, not really. You just get it, you work for one guy. I was in a country anyway. I was not in Paris. So I spent three years in a country. Then I was French Army for 2.5 years.
Yes, so he started his career as a jockey in France, and then was that a mandatory service in the French Army that you had to go to for 2 years?
Yeah, that time, yeah, that was during the war in Algeria.
So your career was interrupted.
For 2.5 years. Then after that, I want to go to Paris, because if you want to make, as a jockey, you got to go to Paris, because in a country, you're going to make a living, but you're never going to eat the top. So I went to Paris, and I was doing okay. And then a friend of mine, that was a big step. A young guy from England, he came to spend 6 months, like they do for Wayne Lucas, the people, stagiaire. And then we become friends. And after that, he came here. And he sent me a letter, Jean, you should have come to America. The way you ride, you're aggressive, you do good.
Okay, so I have to interrupt you because your English is still not great. Yeah. How hard was it then, whenever you came as a young man? You obviously didn't understand or know English yet. So did you have somebody who was helping you, with the language?
Not really, no.
So how did you make your way? Now you're in the United States. You don't have a French interpreter, English interpreter next to you. How did you manage to communicate with the trainers and then with you?
Well, I started in Florida with Horacio Liro, Senior Liro.
You were what?
Liro, Horacio Liro. The guy was training Latin dancer.
Horacio Liro, thank
what
you.
What did I see? You stupid or what?
Yeah, sorry.
So he speaks some French.
Right.
And he described me with the pole, system pole, pole as well. That's all I need to know after that.
Yeah, you just needed to know where the poles were, how fast you want to go, all that stuff. Yeah,
that was. And then I learned, I spent 2 years in France in English, but that, but I did learn watching the TV in the morning.
So watching the TV in the morning, you would learn more English?
Yeah, commercial, stuff like that.
Yeah.
And I got better English than I speak, pretty good writing.
So you pretty much started your career then with Horacio Liro and kind of at Hylia Park and then also in New York. Was that your circuit for the?
Yeah, the beginning. I went to Hylia, that's where I started. I was not really riding a couple of horses. And then I went to New York. And then another trainer, a friend of Monsieur Liro, Jack Wiper, he said, "Why don't you come to Delaware Park?" He said, "You got a better chance to get old. Like, New York is too tough." So we went to Delaware Park, and I got to know all the jumping people. And that's why I became doing so many races on the tour, because I was running those people. And then those people go to Saratoga. So I got some clients come to Saratoga with Jonathan Shepard, Billy Cox, those trainers.
So you were riding for people all over the United States, really? East Coast, West Coast?
But I spent most of the time, after I was in New York, and then back to Florida. Mm-hmm. And then I went to Saratoga again. I got lucky, the first stake I win, I was the Traverse. So that was
the Traverse was your first stake. But it wasn't graded stakes then, but it was owned
by... Yeah, it was a graded stake, but it was like 100,000.
Yeah, owned by C.V. Whitney, who was really part of the main reason why Saratoga
was revitalized. That was from Marie Lou. I won the Traverse from Marie Lou.
Yeah. So in 2004, I have a quote where you said that actually the best horse you ever rode was Hoist the Flag, who obviously did not win the Triple Crown. Why do you attribute him as being the best horse you've ever ridden?
Oh, he was, believe me, you need to compare him. When he went in Béchot, the 7-8 Béchot, he went 2 seconds faster than Secretariat, two seconds fast.
Wow, so he was a good horse. Okay, so let's, because we only have so much time and I've got to open this up for questions, I think we're going to have to move ahead to the Triple Crown races, and let's watch a couple of the races. We're gonna start with Secretariat. We're gonna watch his races. If there's anything you wanna talk about after the Derby, after the Preakness, after the Belmont, just let me know, but I think it's fun for all of us to watch these races again, so let's get them going. They're in the starting gate.
Secretariat throws his head a bit. And they're off. For the lead.
Oh, yeah.
On the inside, that's Angolite for the lead. On the outside, Shecky Green. Royal and Regal, then on the rail, it's Dress on the outside is Gold Bag. They're by the stands for the first time. Chucky Green is showing the way by a length and a half. Royal and Regal now being moved to the inside, looking for room. Gold Bag is up on the outside. Then on the rail, it's Angolite, followed by Sham. Our native, Restless Jet. It's My Gallant, then Forgo. On the outside, Navajo, followed by Secretariat, Warbucks, and finally, Twice a Prince. They're moving on the turn. The leader is Shecky Green, leading by 2.5 lengths. Gold Bag is second by a head. Sham now third on the outside by 2 lengths. Royal and Regal fourth. 2 lengths then back to Angolite in fifth. Secretariat has made a sudden move and is now sixth. Then it's Restless Jet, Our Native beginning to move up. Navajo, Borgo, and Warbucks beginning to move up, followed by My Gallant and Twice a Prince. They're into the turn and bunching for the lead with Shecky Green, still the leader by a half a length. On the outside and challenging is Sham, and he's now got a head in front. Now Shecky Green responds to the challenge, and those two are heads apart. Royal and Regal is third and holding on. Gold Bag drops back. Secretariat is fourth and moving up on the outside and is now third and moving at the leaders as they come for the head of the stretch. They're at the head of the stretch and Sham is the leader. He leads it by a length. Secretariat is in the center of the racetrack and driving. Shecky Green now drops back. Coming on a bit is Forgo, Our Native on the outside. Now on the stretch, it's Secretariat. Secretariat on the outside to take the lead. Sham holding in second. It's Secretariat moving away. He has it by 2.5. Sham, then on the outside, Our Native. That's the wire is going to lead Secretariat. He wins it by 2 lengths. Sham is second. Our Native third by an inch.
So you have to talk about that because you obviously weren't in contention going into the first turn. Were you riding with confidence throughout? Like you just knew you had a lot of horse, or talk to us about the Derby.
I had a lot of confidence in him, but we had a little problems. He started his three-year-old in the Bayshore, and then we came back and they got them and set track record. I put him on the lead that time. Because he'd been coming from behind all that time, I had to try him on the lead, make sure that it wouldn't bother him, that he could also run in the lead.
Yeah, so when you look at his past performance line, he's one of the rare horses who you can see can kind of do anything. So at what point in his career did you realize, I can take him back, I can go to the lead, I can do whatever?
Well, I started working him as soon as he came on the racetrack from the farm. And I schooled him to do both, you know. But in a race, I was letting him get his legs under him. You know, he was like a big overgrown kid.
Yeah.
You know, he didn't know which leg to put down first and in his workout and then so on. In a race, I would just let him draw back. And when I pick him up, he always responded and
so
won.
He was always a really good communicator with you. He would always listen and kind of do whatever you asked.
Yes, he was a very generous horse. He was a kind horse. He was a very manageable horse. I could place him wherever I wanted to. The reason I was way back there that day, when we came after the Gotham, we ran him in a Wood Memorial. He had a big abscess under his upper lip, and he had a blood infection, which I didn't know at all. And I knew is that I didn't put in his final workout, the real fast 5 furlong. We always did with him before his races. I don't know why, but Lucien Orange's father-in-law passed away, and he was away. But I didn't get on him that time, you know, for a week before the Wood Memorial. So I didn't know he had any problem. Mm-hmm. Nobody told me. Anyway, he didn't run the race we wanted to run. He got beat, finished at the third. And I thought that he might be, you know, a little short, so because going into the Derby. So I thought, well, I'll let him gallop along the first quarter of a mile, then I'll pick his head up and start picking my horses up. And he did that very well, and he ran every quarter faster than the last. And he ran the last quarter in 23 seconds, which was a record, and still a record, I believe.
Yeah. So you thought he might not be as fit as you wanted him to be, and you didn't want to get him in the race early, get him engaged.
That's right.
I see.
Even though he relaxed among horses, it didn't matter.
Well, then you put him on the lead for the Preakness. So let's watch the Preakness Stakes, and then we'll talk about it.
Secretariat bobs his head. We're still looking, and they're off.